This week on the Internet Cafe, we'll search for animals on the web. Meet Sierra and find out how she communicates with her pets. Take a virtual tour of one of the nation's leading zoos and check out Roscoe the Cat's webcam. Animals this week on the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience.
And by Audio Highway, makers of the Listen Up Player, which provides digital, portable, customized audio downloaded from the Internet and played anytime, anywhere, on headphones or over a car radio. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise and internet computing news, reviews, features and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. And by Learn2.com, the ability utility.
Now, Jane, does your baby sleep through the night yet?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with sleeping. I had more of a discipline problem in the first year.
You gotta slap him. I slap mine. He smiles at me. He loves it.
Are you feeding it science diet?
I just feed it like hamburgers and noodles, and I think apples and carrots are my choice here.
You guys are driving me nuts with these pets.
Well, this makes sense. These are like the Tamagotchis, the cyber pets. We're talking about cyber animals, cyber zoo.
They're great.
It's logical. People don't have time for real pets anymore. You got to feed them, you got to clean them.
I have time. I love real pets.
You have a pet?
I have two cats, and I like them. I grew up in a household that had all kinds of animals. My dad's son of a Dr. Doolittle.
Wow.
And he was building a big pigeon coop, and yeah, he loves it. So I like that.
You have pets?
I have two big fat cats.
Two fat cats.
And Fred. And you know what?
The digital doggy.
It happens. I know
it's
you really.
It's bizarre.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, you like the real animal stuff too.
I love
too.
Real dogs.
I mean, everybody
real
likes
dogs,
animals, right?
Animals,
How can you not like animals? Yeah, I do too. But I think that, I mean, the Tamagotchi, the cyber pet thing, is interesting because it is a practical. I mean, it started in Japan where people, you know, have little teeny apartments and they can't have animals.
We have it
now. Kids like it. It's a way for them to play with that. And I mean, who knows where zoos are going? I mean, a lot of people don't live in big cities where they have zoos. It's, you know, you don't want to catch animals in the jungle and lock them up in cages anymore.
Well, that's what
so I think.
Like.
Cyber zoos is a pretty good idea. The virtual zoos
are nice for that respect, for not taking animals and caging them. It's actually just a place people can go and see them.
I mean, it's not quite the same thing, but I mean, I think the virtual zoos are pretty cool.
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna look at a lot of neat animal stuff on the web on the Internet Cafe.
I love the zoo, Laura. Now, why would the San Francisco Zoo want to go online? What are some of the things that you do at that website?
Well, we use it basically to tell people what's going on at the zoo. People come to the zoo and see the animals, but they're not always aware of the programs that we might have, what's going on perhaps behind the scenes. We have all sorts of information on the website about volunteer programs, education programs, special events. We have a page called New at the Zoo to keep people posted on what's going on at the zoo. For example, we just have a new exhibit of aye-ayes, which are a species of lemur, and so we just put those on the New at the Zoo page. So that'll let people know what's going on and perhaps inspire them to come to the zoo. And it also gives us the opportunity to talk about our conservation and education programs, things that people might not be aware of. We have extensive conservation programs, such as our bald eagle breeding program.
Now what's that about?
That is, we actually just built a new avian conservation center this past spring, and we've had very successful breeding done even before that. We take bald eagle eggs from, say, Catalina Island that were damaged by DDT, which is pesticide. We take those eggs, we incubate them at the zoo, hatch them, and then re-release them on Catalina Island. And so we talk about that on our conservation page, and it's just a real exciting opportunity for us to talk about that.
Because I know the role of zoos are really quite changing, and they have been changing quite significantly over the years.
Right.
So the conservation and animal preservation element is becoming probably more and more important to you as an organization.
Right. Yeah, gone are the days of the menagerie and just, you know, bunches of animals put in cages just for people's amusement. Now we have something called the Species Survival Plan, or SSP, for different endangered species. And we talk about that on our website, and there's just, we have extensive conservation programs in, say, Madagascar. Our director is the head of the Madagascar Fauna Group, and we also have conservation programs in South America, and we get to talk about that on our website.
One of the things I liked about the website was the adopt an animal element as well. So, I mean, you can actually participate and help those animals, especially those that are endangered.
Right. Say if you have a particular favorite animal, you can adopt an animal, you can get the information on the website. And the money that goes from that program goes to enrichment for the animals, which is improving the lives of the animals at the zoo.
Now, one of the neat things that I saw at the San Francisco Zoo website was the virtual tour, the map of the zoo. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Right. We took our basic map, put it up on the website to orient people to the zoo, to let them know what kind of animals we have. And what you do is you can click on the map and it'll zoom in. And you click on the different icons for the animals, and it'll brings up a page with a photo of the animal and different information on the animal. So it really just familiarizes you with the animals at the zoo. So if, say, you haven't been to the zoo yet, it lets you know what to expect and
so kind of gets you excited about it. It's really interesting. So the virtual zoo is not a replacement for the zoo, but in fact,
right.
There's so much to see. It's mm-hmm. almost a great way to plan your day, especially if you're taking the kids.
Exactly.
You can plan what you're going to do and focus on certain things mm-hmm. and get a lot more out of the experience, I guess.
Right. We use the site just as a way to get information on, say, directions or fees or hours or things like that.
I can volunteer there as well, which I thought was also
right.
nice.
Right. So there's lots of volunteer opportunities. Like I said, we have information on education programs. So there's just lots of different resources on
it. Obviously the most important thing for most people about zoos is to take your kids there.
Mm-hmm.
And now what kind of things do you have at the website that engage children?
Well, we have something called Zoo Talk. Overall, we try to keep the site very kid-friendly. We have, like, large letters, lots of pictures.
Zoo Talk, I like those too.
Great. But Zoo Talk is kind of like a game. We have animal sounds that are recorded, and you click on the button and it plays the sound and it gives you a little clue, so you have to kind of figure out what the animal is, and then you click on the answer button and it gives you a photo of the animal and describes the animal and how it communicates. So it's fun. It's a little game for the kids, but it's also for adults because it's very educational.
There's a woman hanging out at CyberSMith tonight who's got the greatest job in the world. She gets paid to do nothing but surf the web all day long. She also happens to be a cat lady, so we're going to find out what's going on here. Hey, Rachel, how you doing?
Hi.
You're the cat woman, huh?
Yes.
All right, but you're what's called an indexer at Yahoo. I mean, that's a real 21st century job. What does an indexer do?
Well, we get about 5,000 submissions a day, so I evaluate...
To get listed in the Yahoo engine, huh?
Yep.
Wow.
And I evaluate each website and decide where it should go in the catalog.
And you decide which of those 5,000 gets actually in?
Mm-hmm.
You have power. You're a gatekeeper,
yes.
Huh?
Well, there's 50 of us. It's not just
oh
me.
Oh, my God. All right, now you're a cat lady. That's why we're talking to you. Are mm-hmm. you on cats, right?
Yes, two.
Two cats.
Abel and Spooky.
Now... There's all these cat websites, I understand. There's like a couple of hundred of websites for people's cat.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the point? Well, I mean, why?
I think people, cats have a lot of personality,
yeah.
and they also become part of the household. So people think of them as like they'd be making a web page, like people's personal home pages.
Right.
They think, well, why not make one for my cat?
Well, all right, I want to ask you about some of them, because some of these are really weird. I know you have a couple of favorites from the thousands of sites you look at every day. There's one called Claude. What would I find if I went there?
Claude, he's a cat that his owner decided that the research that he could do on cats is a really interesting topic at parties. So he's using his website to collect research for cats.
So there's like serious stuff on
yeah.
there about.
Well, it's kind of serious.
Well, for the web, semi-serious.
Yeah, you can contribute to his research.
Like
he
cat
collects
science?
Research like the time it takes for a cat to how long it takes for the cat to shed its hair.
Oh, that's exciting. All right, let's move on to another one. There's one called Roscoe, and this has, I understand, a live camera on the cat's litter box.
Yes, it's supposed to update every 10 minutes. I have yet to see him, but I check it every day, and I haven't seen him yet.
So somebody really wants to watch this, huh?
I guess.
I mean, you usually hide the litter box, right?
I think it's just like a gimmick.
It's a gimmick. Anything else on Roscoe?
He has his own secretary.
The cat does?
Yes. So if he's away at his office, which is the litter pan,
yes,
you can
leave a message, yes, with the cat's voicemail.
Yes.
All right. One called Willie Elmo. What's that sign about?
That's just your average typical cat website. It has his
an average typical cat website.
It has his nicknames.
Yeah.
It has different pictures of him in different positions.
So it's just about this cat.
Yeah.
So why is it one of your favorites? What's a big deal?
The pictures are really cute. There's a picture of him on his back.
And this is one that has like a gallery of all the pictures?
Yes.
Okay.
And it's in the voice of, like he says, my human units call me little okay. Chubby.
So it's got a cat voice.
Yes.
All right, another one called Madison I know you like. What's the deal on that site?
Madison is the psychic cat, also known as the genius cat.
Ask it questions about your future?
Yes, you can ask it questions, and he will email you back.
The web
with the answer,
isn't it?
Yes.
All right, now guys, you have two cats.
Yes.
Do you have a website for your cats?
No.
Why?
I don't own a computer.
You're an indexer for Yahoo and you don't own a computer?
Well, I spend 8 hours every day on the internet. I don't want to spend any more time at home.
What do you do when you're home at night?
Read. Watch TV.
You told me you have a Nintendo 64.
I do.
That's close.
I play video
games. All right, let's go take a look at some cat websites.
All right, great.
So here's a guest we don't usually see on the Internet Cafe. Who's this?
This is TJ. TJ's a green-winged macaw.
Wow, TJ is absolutely beautiful.
Isn't she?
Now, you have created a website called CyberArk, and I've actually looked at this website, and it's based around a lot of holistic healing and things around animals and telepathic communication with animals.
Right.
How did you get into that, and how did you start this site?
Well, I first learned about telepathic communication when I broke my ankle, and I was in a lot of pain, and my cat, Kisa, I was laying on my pillow and I heard, I know we come from different cultures, but if you'll just pet me, I'll take your pain away.
Now, you actually heard this or you just
I heard it in my head, like someone talking to me.
Okay.
And I opened my eyes and Kisa was right there and I knew it was her. She was looking right at
me. She was looking at you.
And I put my hands on her and fell asleep and slept comfortably for the first time.
Wow.
So that's how I first discovered that it's possible.
So not only did she communicate with you, but she actually provided some kind of healing.
That's
as
right.
Well.
That's
so
right.
You decided to create a website around this?
Right. My brother told me that I could work on the internet and have a free site.
Uh-huh.
I said, okay, great, and I want to get the telepathic stuff on there.
Right.
So I put together that, and I have my story on how I got into telepathic communication, kind of what I just told you.
Okay.
Other people have submitted their sites, their stories to me about
other things that have happened. Similar.
With them.
Yeah, I actually looked. I saw there was like a deer communication. I think that was you.
Right.
And what did you do with dolphins too? I saw a whole site on that.
Yeah, dolphins. I just went swimming with dolphins in June, and it was a very life-changing experience for me.
Wild dolphins
out in the Bahamas.
Wow.
So when I came back, I put together a website and put my story on there and my pictures for my trip, and now I'm taking people out to the Bahamas to swim with dolphins.
Really? When is that's coming up?
There's one coming up in January and then in the summer.
So people can find about that.
People
what
can find
other
out
things
about that.
Are on there that you think would be of interest to people?
There's a lot of holistic stuff. I try to keep really high quality things that I would only use for my own animals on there.
So holistic meaning things that you can do or support your pet with that are maybe not traditional medicine or not buying dog food at the store.
Absolutely, dog food. I have Flint River Ranch dog and cat food on there. It's the best food on the market as far as I'm concerned. I started using it for my own animals first. And
it has better ingredients and things than maybe your...
It's all human-grade ingredients. It's oven-baked. So that's what I feed. And I saw such great results that I decided to become a distributor and put up a website.
Speaking of pet lovers, I saw you have a search engine for animals.
That's
What's different than, say, a Yahoo or something
that? If you go into Yahoo and put the word animal, you're going to get 20,000 sites come up, and it's going to be hard to find the right one and what you're looking for.
Okay.
NOAA only lists animal websites.
Oh.
So you're taking
NOAA's
out...
NOAA's the name of the search
NOAA's
engine.
NOAA's the name of the search engine.
Okay.
It only has animal websites, so...
people are able to find what they're looking for much easier. You don't have to put the word animal in. You could put in holistic, and you're going to find some quality sites come up. Right.
Okay, great. So people can check out that, too. Now, I think you also run an animal sanctuary that you seem to have something up on the site. So
right.
TJ's not your only friend there.
No, TJ's not my only friend.
I've
got birds and dogs and cats and ducks and chickens and... We had a llama, but he just left us, so it comes and goes.
And the llama ran away? Or
no, I took the llama to a new home.
Okay, and did the llama tell you that it was a good home to go to?
The llama told me that he wasn't happy where he was, so we decided to take him somewhere where he's happier. Okay.
Now, how much time do you spend on a site like this, keeping it up and putting up new information?
I try to work on it a little bit every week, but I also try to keep a balance in my life. I can't spend
so
too much time on the computer. Right.
Right.
I work as a paralegal, so I'm on the computer a lot,
right.
So it's all a matter of balance.
Right. How many visitors do you get to this website every week?
Right now I'm getting about 500 a day.
A day?
Right.
Wow. So there's a lot of animal lovers
out there.
So what
Absolutely.
Do you see as the future for your site? Is it something you're going to keep working on?
I'm absolutely going to always work on it. Next week I'm going to put on a video for my dolphin trip so people can actually see dolphins swimming.
So people could actually go on, download this video
and watch.
See the real deal.
See the real deal.
Right.
I have lots of plans. It's just a matter of time and taking the time to do that and keeping that balance so I don't get to the point of resenting it.
Exactly.
I've got to keep a balance, so that's what it's all about. But definitely, I'll keep working on it.
You know, Andrew, the interesting thing about animals on the web is with the web, of course, it doesn't matter whether it's true or real. So there's all these like strange mythological fictional creatures you can look at on the web.
They call it cryptozoology.
I know, I never even heard of that term, cryptozoology. I mean, things like the Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, and all that kind of stuff. Now, I mean, you're into Bigfoot, right?
I like Bigfoot. I think it was in the 70s, there was this movie that came out, Bigfoot. It was a Saturday afternoon thing. I went, my mom took me. Ever since then, I've just been into Bigfoot.
I mean, you believe there's a Bigfoot?
Well, you know, I looked at some of these sites. Yeah. There's been over 400 sightings of Bigfoot, most actually in Northern California, and some pictures of this big, hairy creature, and I don't know. I think it actually could be
real. I mean,
it's
amazing, as you say. I mean, lots of websites.
Yes, yes.
You can go in there and actually have people saying, yes, I saw this.
Right, and you can see some of the actual pictures.
The pictures?
There's even a famous video. It's about a 30-second video of Bigfoot, a big, hairy thing running across this field, and there's all kinds of databases of information you can look at, so it's pretty interesting.
I'm into Nessie, the Loch Ness Monster.
Loch Ness.
And Sam Adam, I'll tell you what I like about some of the websites on Loch Ness Monster. They actually say this photo is a fraud, and this was a fake, and all the rest of that stuff.
So wait, they say it's a fake, or do they
say... Well, no, some of the pictures. I mean, there's that famous picture, you know, of the Nessie sticking out of the water. They say that's a fake. But there's actually, I mean, documented people say, yes, I was walking across this road near Inverness, Scotland, and I saw this huge dinosaur-type thing, and his neck was sticking out, et cetera, et cetera.
So what do you think?
Well, I actually went there looking for Nessie.
You
I was
did.
In Scotland,
wow.
And I went to the Loch Ness, and I stared at that darn lake for 2 hours, and nothing happened. I was praying I'd see it.
Okay. Well, one place you don't want to go is Maryland. You know why?
Yeah.
Because in Maryland, there's the Goat Man.
What is that? I mean, I saw there's a website on Goat Man. I never heard of that.
There's actually two websites. So it's not, you know, as far as the web goes, it's not that common. But the Goat Man was supposedly this creature that attacked these two lovers that were actually sitting in a parked car.
Is this mythology or somebody
no,
really?
No, this is really true.
Somebody
these
saw it.
Two folks were in a parked car back in the 50s, and all of a sudden, this giant half man, half goat with horns on his head came running out, beat their car.
And there's a website on it.
And there's a website on it.
All right, I can top that one. The Goat Sucker.
Oh, the Goat Man needs a Goat Sucker.
Yeah.
Come
well, this is the newest monster, actually, because like only 2 years old, Puerto Rico.
Wow.
A lot of people report seeing something called the Chupacabra. Now, this is like, how do you describe this thing? It's like a vampire that's into animals.
Okay, so Goat Sucker.
Yeah,
so
they
exactly
find these dead
goats
and these dead pets with like weird pierce marks in their neck and the blood gone from the veins.
Wow. Now, is it only in Puerto Rico or has it gone anywhere
else?
No,
it started in Puerto Rico, but it tends to be in the south and the southwest. There have been sightings in Florida.
Oh, so it's coming to the United States.
It's coming.
Too.
Coming
oh,
to
my
a big
God.
Screen.
Okay, well.
No, but these people are serious about it. It's big in the Latino community. A lot of I know the Spanish language radio stations in Miami. There's a lot of stuff on the website about this, the Chupacabra. And you know, there's been articles in the Boston Globe on this. The Chupacabra homepage is on the Princeton University
website. It comes out of Princeton University. So, I mean, there's a lot of weird
stuff
out there.
You're starting to scare me now.
Well, no, Chupacabra will scare you. Actually, and I heard there's a new TV series coming out called The X Creatures, which is all about these, like, strange animals that don't really exist.
Okay.
So, anyhow, there's websites for all these things. Nessie, and your goat
Bigfoot.
Man, and Bigfoot, and Chupacabra.
All right.
Come on, let's go. Now, Andrew, I got to ask you, I couldn't really hear about the lady and the parrot. What was that all about that you were doing?
Telepathic communication with your pets. In fact, you can do it with your virtual pet.
All right, come on, seriously.
Stop.
No,
what was she saying?
She was saying that basically people and pets can communicate telepathically with each other.
Like ESP between you and your parrot?
Something like
that. What do you think of that?
Something like that. I like it. I believe in it.
You believe in it?
I kind of do.
Well, you figure Dr. Doolittle. Your dad.
Well, it's a movie.
Right.
No, but you think about Native American culture. They talk about animals and the roles that animals play in their lives and, you know, connections and stories that the animals have for them.
Right.
I believe that animals have feelings.
I think that
emotions
animals can figure out what we're doing. I'm not sure we can figure out what the animals are doing. I mean, animals do, like, have this sense, like, they know when you're about to go away, right? And they know when you're sick. I mean, animals do have some way of reading body language, maybe it is, or I don't know what it is.
You don't think we have the capacity to?
Well, we have trouble understanding humans, right? I mean, we're going to understand dogs or parrots.
Let me tell you one thing. My father loves animals and taught me to be very, you know, sort of sacred about animals. And whenever I come across an animal in the wild, I always feel like it's a very good omen. It's something very special.
Really?
That it
Absolutely.
Means something good is going to happen to me, that I was honored to be at that place at
you're
that
kidding.
Moment.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I'm kind of
into it.
Now, Jane, I want to ask you, isn't there this whole thing about shelters and pets and animals on the web also?
Yeah, actually, it's one of my pet interests, shall we say.
Oh, okay.
But, I'm a big advocate of animal rights and looking after animals, shelters, and those types of things. And one of the interesting sites that I found was petsinneed.org. And this was an interesting site in that this local community group had started this pet shelter, and they set up a website, and now they've got information about activities that they've got, like the dog wash clinics that they're going to
have. Just like a virtual SPCA kind of thing.
It is. And then they have pictures of the animals, whether it's dogs or it's cats or what have you, and they put pictures up of abandoned pets.
Is this
local or national? I mean,
this particular website is local, but I know of many different animal shelters who could probably benefit from pulling together, because this one site actually found a home for these coon hounds. They were Bay Area dogs that had been abandoned, and they found a home for them in Pennsylvania, of all places, because they posted it on their website.
Maybe you put your virtual pet up there.
I keep Fred close
Well, you know,
my
we've
heart.
Talked about things like, you know, cyber dating and matching people, and that's a great idea, really.
Yeah.
Use the power of the web again to match animals with people who want animals
Absolutely.
And animals in each homes and so on. That's a great idea.
Oh, I thought it was
But
awesome.
It's hard for the animals to use the computer, isn't it?
On the web, they don't know you're a dog.
Oh, you're
don't
right.
you remember
okay.
that joke? I just want to add one thing before we wrap up here, and I mean, this is, unfortunately, in today's world, you have to talk about this kind of stuff, but I just want to warn parents, actually, you know, if your kid goes on the site, or a search engine and looks for animals and pictures,
right,
you sometimes
zoos.
Find some very nasty stuff about animals and people doing weird stuff, so
right.
one should be aware that you may not want your kids looking for animal pictures on the web by themselves. In today's world, anyhow.
Parental guidance.
Anyhow, but there's a lot of great stuff, as you saw, animals on the web. So hope we'll see you here next week again at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience.
And by Audio Highway, makers of the Listen Up Player, which provides digital, portable, customized audio downloaded from the Internet and played anytime, anywhere, on headphones or over a car radio. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise and internet computing news, reviews, features and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. And by Learn2.com, the Ability Utility.
To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify show number and topic.